Welcome to Growing Your Dental Business, hosted by dental business coach and author, Benny Reed. This podcast is the ultimate resource to sharpen your focus and accelerate your results, ultimately leading to more profit at the end of every month. Here's your host, dental business coach, Penny Reed.
Welcome to episode 6 of the Growing Your Dental Business Show. This is Penny Reed. I'm so excited to have Janice Hurley on the show today. Janice is known as the expert to the experts, and in dentistry, she's known as the image expert. In today's marketplace in dentistry, how patients perceive us, it has a direct relationship to the profitability of the practice. Most patients don't grasp what quality dentistry really is, but they do understand how they perceive us, what sort of value they derive from the image that we have, and also how we make them feel. So I've heard Janice at dental conferences, through National Speakers Association, and I've also had the privilege of being one of her clients. So she has an awesome message, and without further delay, let's get started with Janice.
Well, I'm so excited to be with you today, Janice, and mainly because I know how powerful your message is and cannot wait for there to be another avenue and sampling of your message for the podcast listeners to hear. So welcome. Glad to have you.
Thank you so much. Delighted. We go way back, don't we? My goodness.
We do. Of course, we're so young. It's amazing.
Oh, I'm sorry.
How far back we go. Right. So I would love for our listeners to hear how you became known as Dentistry's image expert.
Yes, it was just one of those organic things that took place. I had been speaking on a regular basis on successful practices for the dental owner and his team, you know, those things, those systems that needed to be in place that were so crucial. And in speaking, I would show before and after photos of the doctor and before and after photos of the team in terms of what we chose for clinical attire and professional attire for the front desk. So from head to toe, I might show a photo of a doctor that was in scrubs before, but he looked much different in a dress slack and a white shirt tie and a lab jacket. So, you know, it was all about their area, who their target market was, and the type of dentistry that they wanted to do. So before you know it, instead of being invited solely on talking about new patient interview or treatment presentation, I would be asked to speak on image within the dental practice. And one thing kind of led to another. So, yeah.
That's awesome. Well, and it's not only the power of first impression, but it's the consistency of the impressions that we make in these long-term relationships that we have that are so important. What do you feel like, what are the big important image issues that dentistry as a whole is facing today?
Right. It's the fact that things are changing in terms of the way their patients today are receiving information or making judgments about them. So we used to spend time on our website and look at it on the big computer in the office, when in reality, about 75 to 80% of the time, someone is looking on their iPhone and checking you out, you know, via that avenue. And so what's more important than ever now in your image is getting professional photographers to take the right type of photo. So you don't need a photo of your CERAC. You need a photo of your patient smiling and looking happy when they're interacting with the doctor or the team. And it's old school to line up our team and have them, you know, up against the wall and take a photo of all 8 or, you know, 30 of them. Instead, one-on-one photos, more dynamic, more current. So one of the things that are changing is our audience is so much more sophisticated, and we know that unless we get involved by doing videos, great informational short, you know, 45-second videos, can be as short as 30 seconds, then we're missing the boat because it shows that the average person will check out 5 different doctors, you know, that are usually within their insurance carrier plan, if that would be one of their criteria, and they're twice as likely to click on you if you have a great headshot, and 5 times as likely to continue finding out about you if you've got a video, but it has to show up on that very first page on the iPhone. So the average office has not looked at what their website looks like on the iPhone. So that's really changing. And the other piece is, Penny, that, you know, some of the private practices, the kind that we used to work with, and there's still some out there, right, maybe 10%, if that, they've got to keep up with the fact that corporate is issuing traditional, everybody wears the same type of uniform. So from head to toe, it's being outlined. And we used to think that corporate meant less quality dentistry and a less positive or sophisticated visual look, and that's really not the case. So it's sometimes the single doctor that's way behind. I can't tell you the number of practices that people bring me in, and they have me come in for a 30-point image assessment, only to find that the basics, there's a hodgepodge of scrubs, and there's not consistency. And you just can't do that anymore. You just can't do that.
Well, there's not consistency, or, you know, not thinking of anyone in particular, but sometimes I feel like I've gone back in time when I go into some of these offices, because as they say, they're not in very many other dental offices. You know, they might go in one or two friends' offices, but they don't see. And then the impact, not only for the doctors that are getting on in years and possibly looking to transition their practice, whether it's to a group practice or if they're, you know, lucky enough to find a solo practitioner that's getting to be a smaller pool to buy their practice, they're also looking at that image. So it's not only how the patients perceive it, but also these young doctors coming in have a greater, you know, higher level of expectation for sure.
Absolutely.
It's just fascinating. And I would imagine, and I don't know if you can put a time marker on it, but would you say there's a big difference between the practices that maybe started in the last 10 years? I mean, there's sort of a shift that took place at some point where these guys grew up on Facebook and Instagram and smartphones.
Right, very much so. And they also, the dental schools now are including CERAC and the comb beam. And so technology is first and foremost just very easy for them, where the older offices, part of what's holding them back in their image is maybe they're not on board with the way they communicate with their patients, right? They're still making phone calls. How dated is that? It's inefficient, ineffective, and it actually doesn't honor your patient when you haven't asked them, you know, how do you want to be communicated with? Do you want a text? Do you want an email? You know, how do you want that to look? So the newer doctors are more savvy about technology, and they're training their team to talk about it to the patient. And they also are more clear that first impression, lasting impression, so they're looking at the reception area. And I think some of our older offices, they just have old, dated colors and cheap furniture, and it ends up affecting the patient's overall perception of the type of dentistry that they're getting done.
Absolutely. And I don't know, you probably have a more researched answer on this than I do. I usually go by a rule of thumb. Well, number one, I will tell an office, include your facility updates in your marketing budget. You know, and I usually say 7 years. You might say that it's more often, but every 7 years, pretty much everything visually, internally should be overhauled. Not that they have to do it all at once, but the paint, you know, the flooring should be changed, updated, and that's not necessarily my gift as far as like yours to be able to look at something. But what would you say as far as keeping things up to date? How do you advise offices, or how often, to make changes?
I probably have a wider grace period. I would say more close to maybe 8 to 12 years, that window would be just fine. We don't change colors too much. It really, depends on the quality of carpet, what you put into it in the first place, right? So if it's cheap furniture, it won't last very long. I mean, a cheap lamp looks like a cheap lamp, and wear and tear on carpet will show depending on how expensive it was in the first place. So some of the things that will change might be colors, but definitely some things that are changing are the way we portray our dentistry. So it's kind of old school to do the before and after as much as it is now. You want to take photos of happy patients. That's what we're that's what we're drawn to. And when you do show some of your dentistry in terms of before and after, it needs to be impeccable right now because your patient has a much more sophisticated eye. And that bathroom, let's start with the bathroom, the way the bathroom looks and smells. I can tell you that I've actually gone into offices where they have a plunger by the side of the toilet. Ever seen that?
Oh, boy. Yes.
Yeah. Another one had a yellow, one of those yellow plastic folding signs that said, be careful, wet floor. Another practice didn't turn the hot water on because he thought that that would be, you know, too expensive. So you have a healthcare professional who is having his patients wash their hands without hot water. It's these type of things that the new patients will notice more, right? So when you very first come into practice, your eye and your senses are heightened, and you're going to notice just about everything.
That's great. Oh, it reminds me, and this has been about 22 years ago, we had wallpaper, right? I mean, that was very popular back then.
Yes.
In our patient restroom. And there was a little spot on it that was peeling, and we had just sort of tolerated. I mean, it was tiny until a little 8-year-old boy went in there, and he was in there for quite a while. And he actually helped us out a lot because he peeled most of that side of the paper off that he could reach while he was in there. So that it probably needed to be changed before then, but he gave us a little bit of a boost. That was hilarious. I never will forget going in there. I was like, wow. What would you say that most practices, I mean, you've touched on some things already. What are some other areas that you feel like they might really need to get moving on that they haven't addressed already?
I think they tend to ignore their review sites, so health grades or yellow pages, all of these that come up long before the website comes up. So if they don't own that or claim it, then on Google there'll be this unfortunate aerial photo of their practice that just looks horrid, right? It's not a good representation of them at all. But unless they make that choice to go in and replace that with a professional photo or a photographer knew to take that photo early in the day or late at night with a wide-angle lens, then you're going to get this horrible first impression. And the other thing that's happening is they really have to address their social media footprint in terms of reviews. You know, if they get a bad Yelp review, make sure you respond right away. If you don't have as many reviews as you want, you need to be asking for them, and you need to be clear with your patients that, you know, they already have to be active with Yelp and giving reviews on the dry cleaner in the restaurants and the pet groomer. Otherwise, if it's that one-time Yelp review, right, Yelp knows, and they kick it down to the bottom, and they unfortunately love to keep the bad ones on top. But the reality is today you are going to get a bad review somewhere, sometime, right? Every office does. And the two things I tell people is respond immediately, make sure it looks like the answer came back from the doctor, and your first sentence says, I'm so sorry, that's what you experienced. Now, I'm so sorry, that's what you experienced doesn't mean that's really what we did. It just means that's what they experienced. And the second thing is that they have to believe some of what is written about them. So take some of those reviews that say it takes forever to get an appointment in this office, or I can't believe how rough the hygienist was, or they weren't clear about what it was going to, you know, cost for me to go. And instead of poo-pooing it and saying, oh, that was just a unusual patient, you know, take time to look at yourself and reflect. I know that we do that, right, as consultants and speakers.
Sure.
We look at what people say, and I think it's too easy to just ignore, and when in reality it has value.
Well, right. I mean, those critiques, they may not feel so great at the time,
no.
But it really, I mean, if it for everyone, now there are always those oddball negative reviews that are, just seem to come out of left field, but if it is something that people are pointing out consistently, there are bound to be dozens of other patients that feel the same way, and
exactly.
they haven't given you that feedback. So, you know, in the past we would say, oh, you know, we'll have them complete a survey, you know, and I know if surveys are short, some patients will complete them, but they are a lot more likely to go out and put that on Yelp or even on your Facebook page. In thinking about when you were talking earlier about the video, one of the things that cracks me up when I look on a client's website, and I mean, whether I'm the patient or going in as a consultant, if I'm a patient in a medical practice, I want to know what the doctor looks like. And some of the funniest responses that I've heard when the doctor's photo isn't out there is like, well, I'm really hoping to lose weight, or you know, I'm just not comfortable. You know,
taking
who knows?
Photo.
I probably said that at some point, but yeah, I'm just not really comfortable. You know, I'm kind of shy. I'm introverted. And I said, well, let's just think about this for a moment. They're going to see you when they come in anyway.
Eventually.
So it's not like this is a big surprise where, you know, where you get to wear a costume, you know, while they're in there. So it's making yourself look more relatable. It's not like you're trying to look like the dentist to the stars, but to look like a real human being that would listen and be caring, and that you're dressed well, you take care of yourself, you take care of the practice. But now that's one of my favorites is, well, and even with video, I don't like the way I sound. Well, aren't you going to talk to your patients when they come into the office?
That's a good point.
You know, so that's one of the funniest reasons, or you know, probably nicer than to say excuses about not having the pictures out there. And wow, photography has changed so much. You know, it used to be we would take pictures and cross our fingers and wait, what, a week or, you know, 24 hours if we dropped it off at the overnight photo place to see, well, were they any good? And now we can get great pictures in real time.
And we absolutely can take control of what that end result is. And it's not about hiring a family member to take a photo. It's really should be in your budget. You know, you talk about the reception area and the furniture and such needing to be budgeted in. I think we have to make a much bigger budget for a photographer. That means you want somebody that you're paying at least $300 an hour. You block it off at least, you know, twice a year. We do 3 to 4 hours twice a year, and we invite patients in for those photos, and we take team photos, and we actually control the photo shoot, because we've made lists ahead of time as to what it is we're trying to communicate. We control the photo shoot by making sure the backdrop is really clean. You know, those stock photos that we're, you know, we can tell what they are now, but part of what you're drawn to is how clean they are. They're have the person in front in focus, and they've made the camera settings such that it's all, you know, blurry or buttery in the background. And so I tell my clients, love the lens, love the lens, love the lens. That means the part of the reason that you don't like the outcome is when you don't feel good about yourself, you freeze your face up. And you don't have to be gorgeous and perfect and all of that. What you need to do is look approachable and relaxed. If you look like you like yourself, I'm going to be more comfortable with you from the very get-go. So those photos are extremely important. Just that's the way our patients are finding us and relating to us. And one quick point about a video. You know, we say a photo or a picture is worth 1,000 words. A video is worth 10,000 minimum. It's the fastest, quickest way to connect to someone because they hear our voice. They look at our eye contact, they watch our body language, and those videos and the way you produce them need to be every bit as controlled and as professional as you can possibly come up with, even though you only need to use an iPad or an iPhone, control the sound in the room and control what people wear and the backdrop. You know, we take flowers that you had at the front and put them in the back of the patient for the consultation room, and I tell my clients that you invite those patients that you know would be happy and effervescent and enthusiastic about you and who would represent the type of patient that you want. Tell them they're going to introduce themselves, let them know how long they've been in the practice, and give three reasons why their friends and family should see Dr. Frank. And we have to spend time doing that if we're a new practice, an ongoing practice, or somebody ready to retire. It's essential.
Well, and I think the essence of where you're coming from with this is patients don't understand what great dentistry is. Now, they know that if you hurt them, right,
yes.
They know, okay,
yes.
She hurt me or she didn't.
Yes.
They know it feels good when I bite and chew or it doesn't. It stayed in or it fell out. Okay, so
yes.
So
yes.
If it feels good and if it looks good to them, which is way different than if it would look good to your dental colleague, they don't know how to evaluate that. They only can evaluate the way that we make them feel and the experience. And sort of leading into another question for you, I know a study that I saw several years back that I have really put together a lot of the message now for my clients is the critical trends in dentistry, and that is that patients are having to pay more out of pocket. I mean, I know the PPOs are increasing and other types of plans, but the bottom line is patients are still having to pay more out of pocket for their cost of care, and that's going to continue. So we have to hit everything on all cylinders to help them create their want to. And so one of the questions that I had for you is, how do you see the future of dentistry, and you know, whether you want to address the point that I just made or take it a different direction, what do you see as the future of dentistry?
I think the future is really, really bright if that's what we focus on. If we keep on trend with the connection between oral health and physical health, if we're excited about approaching people in terms of getting their mouth healthy, and that we don't lapse into the horrible terms that the insurance carriers have taught us over the years, right, that they've maxed out. Instead, verbal skills are every bit as important, if not more, moving forward, because you do have to understand that none of us actually make decisions to move forward based on facts. It has to come through the heart. Mm-hmm. Something has to be felt. And so I think the future of dentistry looks amazing because there's more and more outside entities that are singing our song, which says your mouth is so important and you need to get healthy. Mm-hmm. But if we continue the really old school, unfortunate, bad habits that we've had when we verbally communicate to a patient, if we still say, doctor says you need a crown, versus celebrating that person would like to fill in that space or get comfortable, if we don't connect with what is important to them, we're missing the boat. So I think we're fighting for discretionary dollars, but if we think it's just going to be on facts and making them feel bad about themselves because we keep saying you need to, then it won't be as much fun. But I think the vision for dentistry is amazing. I mean, we're the number one profession out there, right? And that's for
absolutely.
Good reason.
Absolutely. And I think talking to patients more about and actually asking them, it's what do you really want? And you mentioned, you know, depends on what we believe and what we focus on. If a patient tells you they only want to do what insurance will pay, I don't know how much I believe that. That may be the first thing that they tell you, but that's not necessarily everybody's value. So if we look at everything through that filter, then we go into the scarcity, Walmart, low-price leader mode, which isn't very fun. I used to work for Walmart. Not my hands start sweating every time I think about being in management with Walmart. But I think there is that segment that may only want that, or they think that that's important. But when you ask them what they really want for their oral health, it's a huge conversation and direction changer. And even though I think today's dental teams have to be more tech savvy. I think, and it's one reason why I think your message is so important, that human relations component, that's going to be, you know, the tech is going to be very similar no matter what practice you go to in the future. But it will be the communication, the interaction, and, you know, how they perceive us that will really separate the practices that are more successful from the ones that are struggling.
And think about this, Penny. Our team members, many of them are 35 and younger, correct? And they text and put their head down a majority of the time. They don't pick up the phone and call anymore. And, you know, I mean, either do we for the most part.
Right.
But unless they're trained to be present when they're talking to the other person, unless the office has been really clear about how important it is to connect and the things that they can do, unless that paperwork asks that important question, you know, on a scale of 1 to 10, how important is your dental health? And then on a scale of 1 to 10, where would you rate it right now? If we don't ask the question and then we don't read the answer, right, if we don't read that in general their dental health importance was a 6 and they rate themselves now a 6, then we've ignored what was important to them. And just like you said, they absolutely can respond that they only want to do what their insurance will cover. And we can never make them wrong, but we should be nodding and saying, I can totally understand that. I can see that. And then later we talk about their health and let them know that they'll be able to make good use of their benefits and move on forward.
But absolutely.
I think more than ever, Penny, you know, what you're doing and what I do is just crucial for the practice success, because we can't do it without understanding how to communicate.
Sure. Well, also, one of the first encounters that I had with you, it was probably, as far as a face-to-face encounter and getting to watch your magic, may have been around 2007 at the American Association of Dental Office Managers Conference, where you introduced, you know, the Office Manager of the Year and you showed their transformation. And when I think about, you know, we're not only looking to impress and make that sort of impact on our patients, but I often wonder not only how the dentist shows up and appears from a image standpoint, but also the office manager, if it doesn't help them gain more respect from their team. I don't know if you would like to touch on that as well, because we're seeing larger practices with greater management in them. There's like a layer or two of management that wasn't even there in most offices 20 years ago. So how do you see that coming across as far as leadership and respect within the team?
Right. To ignore that aspect, ignore the fact that your energy, how you feel about yourself, your confidence is going to impact how everybody responds to you. And it's a circle. The way people respond to us tends to teach us how we should think about ourselves. So if you respond to me like you respect me, or you think that I have a position of authority, then that goes inside to me, and then I'm going to act more the part. So that particular year, I remember there were about 50 applicants, people that wrote in an essay to say why they thought they should, you know, win the ADOM makeover. Mm-hmm. And the woman that I chose was somebody who was 48, who said that when she looked in the mirror, she felt like she was in a rut, and that she was the office manager at a large oral surgery group, had about 30 women underneath her, and she said, they're all younger, but I can't seem to get them to respect me. So one of the things that I asked her before I chose her was to send me a photo of what she looked at that moment in time in the office. And there she was in white athletic shoes, a kind of a sweatshirt and a kind of a dowdy look overall. And in talking with her, she was smart, articulate, really knew what she was doing with the practice, but she didn't portray it. And I've seen her several times later, and she's never looked back. In fact, she's just moved forward further and further all the time. So
that's awesome.
We teach people how to treat us. And I ask all of us, I mean, you and I have had this conversation before, if I were to take a photo of myself on a scale of 1 to 10, how much am I projecting that I care about myself, that I value myself when I showed up for work? And then on the same token, how much am I communicating by the way I look, how much I value the people that I'm working with? So, right? I mean, you show up every day like it's important. When we go to a birthday party or church or someplace that we've been trained or taught to respect that other person, we dress for it. And it's highly impactful, highly impactful. That's one of the ways that people work with me. I have a conversation here fairly soon with an office that heard me speak 5 years ago, and we're working virtually now on getting uniforms in place for the back office and professional attire in place for the front. So we're going to be looking at what their choices might be. And when he and I first talked, I said, "What are they wearing now?" And he said, "A hodgepodge of everything." And sure enough, that's what the photos show. And you just can't make that mistake.
Right, right. Well, who would you say primarily seeks out your services? Who would you say are your most common types of clients?
The men or women that come and spend one-on-one time with me here in San Diego, who have makeovers with me or they have executive coaching, they are people that know it's time. They've recognized that they're really good at one aspect of their life, but they're not getting the growth that they want. They're not getting the relationship connections they want. They're not getting the respect. And they're willing to invest in somebody else. So they're people that don't want to be stuck, and it can be men or women. I've had numerous couples come down, which is very fun. So women take a little more time because often with women, their hair and makeup is important, but that's who I would say individually come and work with me. And sometimes it's employers that will send their team members to the workshops that I do. So I have a workshop here end of April, and it's just for, you know, six women only, 2 days, and it's full. And two of the women that are coming are dentists that have sent their team members. And so that's, that's one way. And then the dental practices that work with me are people that are usually really attentive and good on other areas of their life clinically, you know, within the practice. And because I do a 30-point image assessment and they've heard me speak, they're like, "Come in and find out what it is that we're missing." And, of course, there's tons of things. It's really hard for us to see ourselves. So I come in for a day, and we work on things and analyze and set up goals, and then I come back again in 3 months, and that's the way they work.
Wow. Well, how would you say when you do work with an individual or an office, you know, what would you say are maybe the top ways that they utilize the advice or expertise that you give them?
Definitely in terms of attire. Oftentimes, male or female dentist doesn't want to address that delicate subject, and so I have no problem doing that because I introduce it visually. I show them, you know, befores and then what's different about the after and allow them to see themselves. Secondly, I would tell you that the office is often not aware of the fact that the phone isn't being answered. It's going to the message. Or people are picking up the phone and very quickly saying, "Thank you for calling Dr. Kohler's office. Will you hold, please?" Right? I prefer that whatever it is you have to say, you say it slower. Maybe you say less. So that is very, very impactful. And definitely we look at their photos. So I take professional photos. So oftentimes we'll make sure to schedule that. And so by the time I leave, they have photos that allow them to update their, you know, their social media and their website. And then the fourth piece is often from the moment you enter their parking lot to the exterior of the building to the walkway. I think offices often have a pattern of going in the back door, right, all the time, and they never see it. And then we address the doesn't cost anything, but so important aspect of care calls and, you know, putting up a welcome sign for every patient. There's a little, you know, whiteboard. Then they can say, "Welcome, Penny," or "Welcome back, Penny," or just acknowledging what the patient had to say the time before. Personal connection. I think you're exactly right. We can bring in all the tech, high tech you want, but making sure that we're still treating people and understanding what it takes to connect and never make the patient wrong.
Yeah, and I couldn't agree more about in the dental office that I worked in, you really had to be intentional about coming in the front. You know, we parked around back, and there would be, you know, when we got the newspaper delivered, which a lot of offices now may not even take the paper. I mean,
the
local newspaper in Memphis has shrunk to the point of, I don't even know, they probably struggle to find enough content to put in it to merit even getting it. But there would be times that there would be different things out there, trash. But one of my favorite stories over the last couple of years, and this is not a client of mine, you know, maybe they might entertain hiring me or you after I tell you the story. This was not around Halloween. I happened to be in their town working with another client and was heading out, and I thought, you know, I'm just going to pop in and say hello. I had met this doctor at a conference, and I went to the front of their office. I think I just had a morning meeting. It was lunchtime, and the door was locked. Nothing says we don't want your business like having your door locked in the middle
of the business.
I mean, I know that they were at lunch. I know that they were at lunch, but maybe it's my retail background. That just sends out a message, you know, that I think most of the time we want someone there if someone walks in. But
absolutely.
Over the front, so the door was locked, and then as I got back in my car, I didn't notice it when I pulled in the parking lot. There was a giant spider web. I mean, this would have been a great Halloween decoration, but it wasn't Halloween. It was huge. I mean, it might have been like 3 feet by 4 feet. So what does that say about that practice?
Yeah.
That there's looked like it was closed. Like they weren't
open.
And it's, you know, little things like that, I think, that we don't pick up on. We drive past it every day. We don't even see it. I'm terrible. You know, I could drive past something on my street and I won't notice it, but someone else coming down my street would say, hey, did you see that sign or did you see that house? And I'm like, what house?
Even for ourselves, we don't take full photos of ourselves from head to toe. We don't look at ourselves from the backside. We just look from the front, the shoulders on up, and hope for the best.
Mm-hmm. Well, and I think it really comes down to their blind spots. You know, so we have them, you know, physically, it's the whole, my husband's here, I'll say, look at the back of my hair, and he's kind enough that if I don't ask him to look at the back of my hair, he may say, hey, hang on a minute, we need to do something about the back of your hair.
But
we have them at work, and again, it's the familiarity part, we can delete those things that we see on a regular basis. And I think your message, and maybe I've heard you talk about this before, because, having known you through National Speakers Association and listening to you talk to those groups and then also in dentistry, but it's congruence. You know, does our brand match our image? Does our communication match? You know, in other words, one of the easiest things, not to belittle what you do, because I couldn't do it. I mean, you've got it going on. But I would imagine the image things are some of the easier things. And that changing the image probably precipitates the increase in the self-confidence, which precipitates the increase in decision-making. It's huge. So these are things that I imagine most people could change in a matter of days,
whereas
some other things in their office, other skills might take weeks, months. So I'm a believer. I'm raising my hand up as I'm saying it, and your message, and very excited to have the opportunity to visit with you and to have the listeners get to experience you as well. So the website here where the podcast is posted, you'll see Janice's information with her website and contact information, and I strongly encourage you, of course, to work with Janice. But you know, if you do see that she is at a trade show where you are, and you're debating about whether or not to even go, or you're sending your team, don't miss her course. It's also a lot of fun, which I think people learn so much more when I know I do. I'm the world's worst seminar participant, unless I'm completely engaged, and I've always enjoyed your programs.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. Have a wonderful day.
All right. Thank you, Janice.
Thanks, Jenny. Bye-bye.
Thank you for listening to the Growing Your Dental Business Show podcast. For resources and additional information, please visit growingyourdentalbusiness.com.